Monkeys RPG Podcast. Sound off.
My name's Greg.
This is Eric.
And I'm Kyle. Coming up in today's episode, we will be contrasting 5th edition D&D and Pathfinder. We have an email
from Guy.
Guy, yes. So let's just jump right into it. Guy writes, while you were discussing the cipher system, you reminded me of the RPG Og. It's one of those quick and easy one-nighter games that's just stupidly fun to play. You're a caveman, and all you're trying to do is survive the world. The funnest part of the game is that while talking in-game, there's a list of only 17 words you can use, and your character doesn't know them all. If you've never played it, I highly suggest that y'all try it. Like I said, it's stupidly fun.
I have to say that I've never heard of this game.
I have seen it, but I've never played it. I think maybe it was on the used game shelf at the last used gaming auction or something like that.
Was it a flip? Was it the Warhammer Quest where it was just single?
I remember a book that was just named Og, and that's what I remember about it. I didn't pick it up. I haven't played it, but I've seen it. And that does sound, like a one night of fun. My wonderful wife is trying to get us to play a game called Cat.
Right, right.
And where you...
Hold on, the camera can't see me roll my eyes, can it?
No. Which we are going to play sometime, but the premise is you play a house cat and you're protecting your owner against goblins and stuff, the monster under the bed kind of thing.
Sure.
And it's from... same company that did 7th Sea.
John Wick?
Yes, it's from John Wick Presents. Okay, yeah. So, and we got it at his booth at Gen Con, and my wife has been super excited to try to play it, and I've had to crush her dreams every time she's brought it out, because I will play it with her because I'm her husband and I love her, and maybe it'll be fun. But none of our friends seem too enthused to try it just yet, and yeah. I feel bad because she's really excited about playing this game.
You know, so.
It's a very her game, though.
Yeah, that's true.
But there's something to be said about games that aren't serious. You go in knowing that they're not serious, and those sometimes can be the most fun just because you... A lot of times we take the games that we play super serious, and and especially if you're a game master and you're coming up with an adventure for your group, and sure you're going to throw a little bit of levity in and the adventure and things like that, but a lot of times as a game master you're running the game and people go off on tangents or start acting goofy, and it's almost like insulting because it's like, quit shitting all over my game, right? So going into a game like that, like Og, like, like Cat, Pretty Princess is another one of those, like, sit down and play games. You go into it knowing that you're going to be goofing off. And it actually lightens the mood. It makes the game itself is fun, and you start laughing at stuff that, normally maybe you don't laugh at, and you put people in situations, or you put yourself in situations that are ridiculous, right? One of the games that I really like to play, and I don't know if you've ever played it, it's called Ninja Panda Taco.
No.
I have it. I'll let you borrow it. It's you can play it with adults and you can play it with kids. The premise is that you have your mastermind and your minion. Supervillain and his minion, and you have to collect all these things to win this game. But you can role play it, and it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun when you play with a kid because kids say weird things and do weird things. And it's also fun when you play with adults because then you can use adult themes, and it's intended to be kind of tongue in cheek. So, it's kind of in that vein. Og sounds very interesting just because I like the whole limited vocabulary thing. That sounds really fascinating to me.
Had a on that topic, I had a friend of mine play a half ogre who had like a one or two intelligence, and he could only speak in as many words as he had intelligence. So he was having to communicate the entire time in game with either one word or later two words, maybe even three words. We're having to explain to him in concepts he could understand.
Right.
And it made it fun because we had more fun just trying to explain a concept of money using only one and two words to him that the only words he could understand. And it was fun in that aspect until it started completely sidelining the game. But things like that, little things like that, little quirks and nuances, just they're a lot of fun to me. Until somebody tries to enforce it in the middle of battle and stuff like that. And it's just like, okay, look, it was fun, it was cute, but no.
Well, and Aug sounds lighthearted. Cat is lighthearted. There's not a lot of lighthearted in our games lately or really anymore. And part of that's probably my fault. Just the group we're playing with.
Sure.
Well, because we're trying to deal with real situations or we're dealing with serious stuff in each game. You know, it's the 5e game we're playing. It's, all the issues with the giants and everything. And mm-hmm. It's kind of, let's stay on task. Let's move forward.
Right.
And, it's kind of hard to bring an F-off character into a game where you've got a mission focus.
Right.
So.
Talking about the friend of yours that played the half-ogre?
Yeah.
What that reminds me of? It reminds me of Hodor.
Yeah.
Hodor. Yeah. Hodor. You think about one of the most beloved characters of that entire story arc, right, is Hodor. And
so he's probably going to die this season?
Just kidding. Dude, I think you're season off.
Oh, did he?
Spoiler alert.
Right, spoiler.
Yeah. Oh, I was just joking.
No, last season.
I've never watched.
Oh, yeah. I never cared. But, it's one of the more beloved characters of that show and that series is Hodor because it's goofy. He only says one word, and it's supposed to have all this different meaning and everything like that. And, to play a character like that, could add, as long as they bring value to the game itself, sure, why not? And an entire game like that, we've talked about playing Paranoia before. That's a goofy game. It has serious themes and undertones and whatnot, but it's also pretty goofy. So our friend Mike runs a really tongue-in-cheek Hero High that's the
place for lighthearted, especially with our group, Hero High and stuff like that.
Right. His Hero High is less Young Justice and more like Sky High, which is totally fine. And when you go in knowing that the game is going to be that way, it allows some people to really cut loose, and it allows some other people to just kind of let go of, maybe some stuff that you're playing two serious characters all the time or something like that. It's a nice change of pace. I don't know how well I would do in a long-term silly game, but it's certainly something to help kind of like cleanse the palate every once in a while.
I think Kyle brought up last week, Hero High is the only game that our group has ever played where we lost a fight intentionally.
Right.
Because we wanted it on YouTube with these people beating us up. And right. Ultimately, we won. We just wound up hospitalized after the fight.
Right. You take your lumps, but you end up winning the battle, right?
Yeah, that's right. So, Guy, thanks for the recommendation.
Yeah, we'll definitely have to check that one out.
Yeah, we'll have to find a copy maybe on DriveThru or something.
Okay, for today's work call, contrasting the difference between 5th edition D&D and Pathfinder.
Specifically the combat systems.
Yes. Should we do the 5th edition D&D or the 3.5 edition D&D?
The way I see it is 5th edition is like my kid's Kindle Fire, and Pathfinder is kind of like my gaming laptop. 5th edition gets the job done. It gets you there. But I think my gaming laptop gets me there with more style and substance. 5th edition D&D, and I know there are people who like it. I'm probably going to offend you. I don't care. Dumbed it way down. I think, it's a great game to pick up and start playing. The learning curve on it was super easy.
Yeah.
I
hold on, let me take 2 minutes. And my character's done. We're ready to go.
Right.
Yeah.
Pathfinder, especially with the proliferation of splat books out there, has gotten a pretty steep learning curve at this point, unless you just start with new people and only start with the core book, which is a good place to start.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I think that there was this overwhelming almost pressure for D&D, the next edition of D&D, to be more new player friendly. And 5th edition is certainly new player friendly. Oh, there's no doubt about it. No doubt about it. And, you know, the pick up the book to sit down and play time is, like you said, it's just a few minutes. I mean, you can make a character. You don't have to devote a whole night of gaming just to make a character. Also, a major positive for the casual gamer. I think that, to me, and you know, I wanted to reserve my judgment on either, because I wanted to be able to say that I've ran 5th edition, because I've ran Pathfinder before, and I've ran D&D 4th edition, I ran 3.5. So, you know, I wanted to reserve judgment until I sat down and actually ran the game. And I've been doing it for a few months now, and you know, I can see at low levels, there is a major difference between the two games. I don't necessarily agree with the term of dumbing it down, but it's certainly a lot simpler.
Yeah. Dumbing it down is probably a bad term. It is simpler. It's a lot quicker to pick up. Yeah, it's Pathfinder light, in my opinion. I'm okay with that. We need, you know, I'm introducing my kids to role playing. We started a Pathfinder game at home, and we just kind of went core book, you know, core everything to kind of start. And both my kids wanted to play wizards. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's, you know, I'm taking it fairly easy so they learn the rules and can roll the dice and everything else. But they're 8 and 6. So,
right,
you know, It's just moving them in and introducing them slowly so they have fun, and also making them understand there's rules and there's, you know, no, you can't just try to steal the sheriff's magic sword kind of thing, because he's going to beat you unconscious and put you in a jail cell. You know,
it's right.
Consequences to your actions. So 5e combat system, very little math involved. You know, it's pretty much one attack or two attacks per turn at this point in our group. And it's full, there's no such thing as a scaling attack bonus like there was in 3.5 in Pathfinder. You know, Pathfinder, your 6th level fighter, you've got 2 attacks, one's at +6, one's at +1. Then you've got to add in all your intendant bonuses upon that, magical attack bonuses, strength bonus, dex bonus, what have you. D&D 5e is more simplified, which, and let me say this. It may sound like I'm really gonna dog on D&D 5e. I don't want it to sound that way, because anything that brings more gamers into the fold and gets more people out to play, I don't care if you're playing cat. I mean, if right. you enjoy it and you're having fun, then play.
Right.
And don't care about my opinion. You know? Yeah. And I will honestly say I don't dislike D&D 5e with my experience so far. I thought I was going to hate it, to be honest,
mm-hmm.
But I don't. So,
yeah, it was the prospect of having to drag Greg in kicking and screaming to play this game was a real possibility. We almost had to black bag him just to get him into the game.
Ultimately,
pretty much, yeah.
Well, all right. My Monday night games been going on since 1999, even during the time I was in the Army. And I say it's mine because the original group was about 6 of us, and it was me and Eric and a few of the people who are still there now. And so I've taken ownership of it. And so ultimately it's what you're playing on Monday night, and I'm probably going to be there. You know,
right?
So, you know, it wasn't gonna have to be a whole black bag operation and a kidnapping to get me there, especially since my wife and one of my best friends, you know, I've got two of my 4 best friends at the table, and my wife, trust me, you were getting me there. So
we knew that having those cards in place, it was just a matter of time.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so D&D 5e, I can't, I I'm not. Well, let me say it like this. I am having a good time. So, but I prefer a more robust combat rules system.
Right.
I prefer something with a little more meat to it. You know, Hero System will be another show. You know, and I think
there are times that almost gets a little too robust.
Yeah, yeah, but it makes sense. It's a little more real world. So, I don't know much about combat maneuvers in D&D 5e, bull rush, yeah, grip, that, grapple.
Most of that stuff is there in a very pared down sense. So, I mean, a lot of those things, they wanted to get away from the going to the book constantly to try and, you know, figure out to remember what that rule was. Mm-hmm. So, they pared it way down. Grappling is a prime example of that. It's like one roll and you're it, and that's it. You know, rather than the whole, you got to do this and do that and do this, and you know, this whole algorithm of how to get to this one particular, you know, state. So it, in that sense, it's easier. I like the pared down statement. I think that's exactly where it is. It's more user friendly.
And Pathfinder looks daunting at the outset. What kind of got it all to stick in my head, I played a Maneuver Master Monk. And I think I've talked about him before. It's basically, instead of flurry of blows, you get a flurry of maneuvers. So he had a bunch of combat maneuvers. So it kind of helped me learn pretty much all of them. The daunting part about Pathfinder is all the feats that can go with combat maneuvers. I went through and I printed them out. And let's see, there's improved trip, improved bull rush, improved cold shot, improved dirty trick. There is improved disarm, improved drag, improved feint, improved overrun, improved reposition, improved steal, improved sunder.
Greater trip, greater overrun, greater reposition, greater steal. I'm just going through improve right now, man.
Yeah. That's the next layer of the tree. Mm-hmm. And also, to get those, you got to have power attack and combat expertise. So if you're going to, and the good thing about what all the improves do, it gives you +2 to your combat maneuver bonus and removes the threat of an attack of opportunity for doing the combat maneuver.
Right.
So, you know, it is a little algorithmic. It is, you know, a little more robust. It's a little more complicated.
Yeah. And for, I could see where that would be very intimidating to a new player. Now, somebody who plays other games could sit down to Pathfinder and go, okay, I get this. I figured this out, you know. But if you're bringing in somebody who's never played a role-playing game before, and they sit down and they're like, you know, especially people that we've played with before, where it's not those who are self-motivated enough to sit down and read the book will get it. Yeah. But it's the player that you're having to teach how to play the game. And the more complex the game, and you know, I'm not a teacher. I mean, by vocation, that's not what I do. So I'm not good at it. So for me to teach a game, I'm not going to get everything right, or I'm going to have to reference the book and go back and forth. And that really slows the flow down. So D&D 5th edition did away with a lot of that referencing the book. And, you know, one of the things that I really like about 5th edition is the advantage-disadvantage rule. For those who don't know what that means, if the player has an advantageous position or what have you, it's essentially a front-loaded reroll, where you roll 2d20 and you take the best if you're at advantage. If you're at disadvantage, you roll 2d20 and take the worst result. And you're encouraged to apply that in lieu of other bonuses. So if on the fly it's like, hey, I'm up in a tree and this guy just walked out underneath me, do I have advantage? Rather than flip and go, okay, what's the rule for, you know, attacking from above or higher ground or whatever, you flip it, you know, rather than do that, you go, yes, you have advantage. You know, for a rogue or for a thief, having advantage means you get to use your sneak attack. So, I mean, that's huge, you know. I mean, we had an instance just the last time we played, where one of the players was like, well, what do I get? Is there flanking? No, there's not flanking anymore, because that all these situational bonuses they just got rid of. And there are those who think that's a good thing, because you take the more rules you take out, the more innovation and imagination you put in. I don't necessarily agree with that, but I could see where for a new player, it certainly would be that way.
And it also depends on the guy running it. When I run Pathfinder on with our group on Thursdays, you know, I've got anywhere from 6 to 8 people around the table. So I'm running for a big group. And some people are there to have fun. And I've got another friend who is very into the rules. And there have been one or two times I said, you know, I've just made a ruling so we can go on. And, you know, then, you know, they'll come back later and say, well, technically that's only a +2. And it's like, yep, but I'm running the game and we're moving forward.
Right.
I'll try to remember it's a +2 in the future. But you know what? I'm not going to sit here and put the game on hold to look up one rule. Let's go.
Right.
You know, and everybody's having a good time. You know, if my flubbing that one rule broke your immersion in the game, I'm sorry.
Right.
You know, and there are a lot of rules in Pathfinder. It is, you know, more complex. The spell systems, you know, is very reminiscent of D&D 3.5. But I think it's pretty balanced. I mean, when you start putting all the splat books in, get Hero Lab to manage your spells and your character if you're going to run with all the splat books.
Yeah.
Because you run all the campaign setting options. You run ultimate combat, ultimate intrigue, ultimate this, ultimate that. And then you put in all the other stuff.
When you can click a button and it has 80 traits and you never even knew what traits were.
Right.
It can be daunting, but at the same time, you can learn. It's quicker. It's easier to learn. Here's what it is. Here's how it is. And you don't have to find book 12. You don't have to find the advanced planar guide. Not the planar guide. The advanced planar guide for up and coming new. You don't have to get all that. It's right there. Hero Lab is good for that. But that being said, I'm going to take the opposite stance. I flat out don't like D&D 5. I like the fact that it can bring in more people. Sure. I like the fact that it's more story fun. But I'm bored. I'm an obsessive individual when it comes into combat, and I'm looking at the guy going, I either need the spear, I need the warhammer, I need the axe, spinning upon walls, and I'm doing things like that. And in 5th edition, I'm sitting here going, let me wait. Why? Because now he's there, I've got advantage. Sneak attack. And I find myself just sitting there going, and when we get to town, I'm just like, I'm literally having the character do every single out-of-combat thing to do to give me stuff to do.
Right.
While people are arguing, I'm going, okay, well, let me figure up the treasure. So now let me figure up the group kitty, and let me add in and let me base it off of everybody. I'm basically everybody's banker because it gives me something to
do. You're doing the resource management for the group.
Because it helps give me a few things to do and look at contingencies and look at, well, this person got his money, so I don't have to worry about him. This one got his money. Stuff like that helps as far as, you know, it gets me looking and it gets my brain working, whereas I find myself just sitting around going, and don't get me wrong, it's fun laughing and joking and playing with everybody and having a great time, but I also find myself getting frustrated. Mm-hmm. So as the night goes on, I tend to talk less and less because I'm just frustrated because there's nothing to do.
Right.
And I'm trying not to pull out my phone.
Right.
And I'm trying to keep that stuff away from me, but at times it's just like,
Right. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and that was something that I was going to say is I've noticed a marked difference in the way the table, especially with a big group. You would normally say with a big group you want, and I've said it before and I firmly believe this, is that with a big group, you less rules is better because it makes combat faster. But on the other hand, but contrasting these two games, I'm watching the table as I'm running the game, and it could just be a product of, you know, modern, you know, the modern gamer, but when I was running Pathfinder, people weren't on their phones as much because they were looking up rules to see what they're going to do next. Mm-hmm. You know, they were looking up, you know, what different combinations they were going to need, or they were planning out what they were going to do when they leveled up or whatever. I mean, fifth edition D&D, you level up, you know,
45 seconds later, you're done.
You're done. And whereas as a game master, you would say, hey, everybody levels up. It would take better part of an evening to get it, you know, get everything, everybody would level up. As a game master, I would take that time to reflect on some of the things that have been going on and kind of planning my next thing to do that night. Whereas this, it's like, you level up, okay, we're still going. And some people find that refreshing because it's like, okay, we're not stopping the game. But for me, it gave me a chance. It's like, to use a fifth edition D&D reference, it gave me a short rest, mm-hmm. you know? So I could recharge my batteries a little bit and get things going. Or maybe as somebody was leveling up, I could do a little FaceTime for, you know, one-on-one with somebody.
Replanning the story because the entire group went off on some sort of weird tangent and still accomplished the mission. But now what the hell do we do? They burned down an orphanage.
Right.
Changing story, adding in things, figuring out what would be best. It's good to have that time.
Right.
That being said, we decided to recently do Emerald Spire. And we spent most of the first day just making four characters.
Yeah.
And it's still not as bad as Cyberpunk when you can spend 3, 4, 5, 6 days, depending upon how in-depth you want to get into it, just making a low-level runner because there's so much information.
Right.
But I mean, I guess it's just personal preference. I like being able to obsess and to micromanage a character, everything about him. Otherwise, I'm just sitting at the table.
I've got to admit, I was that one of those assholes on Monday who was on his phone. And here's
why. I believe it was me and you.
Well,
it's not like it was everybody.
Well, I didn't. You know, I'd been thinking ahead about what I wanted to do, and my problem is I'll think ahead, but then I get excited about what I'm going to do, and then I sidetrack the game, and I steal more of your attention, and it cuts other people out of the game.
Yeah.
And I don't want to be that asshole.
Right.
So the way I started looking at it was, all right, I'm going to plan my next action, and then I'm going to remove my mind from the situation so I'm not going to get so much farther ahead that I want to move forward and get my stuff done.
Right.
And honestly, it seemed that Monday night was the first night we've had a protracted battle.
Yeah.
That was
8, 9, 10
segments long, and people are forgetting where they're at, and they're forgetting what's going on because they're just not used to that kind of a... It's almost like it's made for the short attention spans.
Yeah.
And we had just marathoned Friday, Saturday, and part of... Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and part of Monday in the Emerald Spire.
Well, that's right. We were on like 7 straight hours of gaming.
Yeah. almost a day. You know, I let my kids just have movie time and, you know, tablet time and everything else. We had our army buddy down from Chicago, and... We said, all right, we're going to play Pathfinder. Let's go. And I took him all the way through to the 11th deep of the Emerald Spire. And we had fun.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, my kids, you know, sat and watched. They, you know, and we took plenty of breaks to feed everybody and everything else. So I, you know, didn't have a whole lot of problem tracking where everybody was. But I was still in that kind of battle map mode
right. From
running a mega dungeon. And you know, I'm running a spellcaster, and a spellcaster in 5e is real easy. It's okay. You know, I'm a wizard. I have a firebolt. I mean, at this point, a zero level cantrip that I can cast, you know, almost infinite number of times a day, that's going to do 2d10 damage is not a hard decision for me.
Right.
So, and that's, you know, 5e spell system is, I don't know. It needs a little balancing, in my opinion. But
some things, yes. Things like your dissonant whispers, you know.
Yeah.
And things like that where, you know, the bard would cast dissonant whispers on, and it's like, okay, well, you know, it's a wisdom save to you know, and if you have a decent bard with a high enough charisma, that save's going to be pretty, you know, it's going to be pretty substantial, 15, maybe 16. And, you know, you cast dissonant whispers on a hill giant, they're, you know, their wisdom's not that great. They're not known as scholars, you know. So you know, a 15 or 16 is pretty hard to do. And so now you've got, I mean, Dissonant Whispers is what, a first level bard spell?
I think so.
And you're casting it against a giant and they're running away. You know?
Demons are running away.
Yeah.
Everything's running away from whispers, something whispering in their ear. It's just like,
yeah.
Maybe it's just because we haven't had a lot from the clerical aspect, but it seems like the bard spell's really overpowered.
Yeah.
The sorcerer spells are nicely powered as far as, well, the arcane spells are nicely powered as far as the mage isn't completely useful until he has fourth or fifth level spells.
Right.
Until you get disintegrated, you're completely useless as a character to me. It seems to have brought up that aspect, but I don't know. It just feels like there's not a use almost for a cleric when you've got potions, not quite galore like you've had in the other game, but okay, let's stop and take a short rest. Okay, we're all healed up, we're all good, let's roll. And then you're going again and everybody's back to healed. It almost seems like it's cutting out the cleric, the need for a cleric.
Well, that's a good point. When you're talking about the healing, when it's a long rest, for those who don't play 5th edition D&D, a long rest is 8 hours, right? Which is traditionally what your rest would be if you were playing, you know, Pathfinder or even old school D&D. It's like, okay, you would need 8 hours of rest before you would get X number of hit points back or whatnot. They've completely gotten rid of all that and said, long rest, all your hit points back. And so then we've been playing for months, and so if you have a cleric, what it does is it frees the cleric from being the battle, you know, the battle healer all the time. But if somebody wants to play a healer, they're almost completely cut out.
Yeah.
And sure, you could people say, well, you could just do other things, but what if that's what you wanted to do? And then you're completely worthless. Some people like playing a healer.
I want to play the battlefield medic. Okay, well, you're going to be a little bored.
Yeah. And it seems so weird. And I know they did it because traditionally that's the way it's always been.
But it seems like in Pathfinder and 3.5 and stuff like that, there were a whole wide number of other spells other than just the healing that were useful. You could become that support character who's there for healing. But it doesn't. It's healing as a spontaneous casting so you can get rid of something you don't need. But at the same point in time, there's something else you can do
Right. Other
than just sitting there. Because I think our healers only had to heal people in combat like 3 times, and 2 of them was this last combat.
Right.
And 1 was himself. But, you know, Right. Whatever.
Well, and the other thing is you're also rolling like 6-7 characters in this adventure. That's
probably meant for
probably 4. Designed for thinking 4. So, I mean, I certainly could jack up the threat, and I still may do that. I've been thinking about it because that's the other thing about 5th edition. Whereas Pathfinder, the monsters, you know, the challenge rating, I mean, they scale. I mean, it's like if you're, you know, X level, a challenge rating, you know, same level of challenge rating is that's challenging for a group of 4 of you. So, you know, that you go into a fight with a monster that you know is way above your class, you get the hell out because you're not going to do anything to them. In 5th edition, that's not entirely the same thing. There are exceptions, but I mean, you guys are fighting major giants, you know, in a 1 or 2. It's not like you're fighting a whole clan of them, but 1 or 2 giants and taking them out in a round.
And we were, at that point in time, even when we were fighting the giants, it was like second, third level.
Yeah.
And everybody's just like, meh.
Yeah. So, and that's the other thing I was going to say about 5th edition, whereas Pathfinder, the combat, it's almost like you get nickeled and dimed to death is what you're doing. Whereas in 5th edition, it's like nothing, boom, it's major. Mm-hmm. And that happened to us in the last game where it was one of the players, like 3 or 4 levels before, she and another player character completely cleared a dungeon by themselves while everybody else was doing something else. And we're talking about the bard and a cleric. Cleared out the rest of they were like second level, and they cleared out like 2/3 of the dungeon by themselves.
They didn't want to wait on the rest of us to finish what we were doing.
Yeah.
So they ran off on their own.
So like on Monday when Mike when the and I same were character doing a ritual and everybody when, yeah. else went.
When the same character ran off on her own. Yes.
Okay. Well.
Although this is the first time I've ever, again, because she's, oh, this will be fun. Oh, I'm not too worried about it. She had to run away Monday because she went, I'm going to die. What I just have happened?
2 hit points left.
Oh God, I've got to get out of here.
Right.
And it's the first time I've ever seen her go, I don't want to lose a character.
Right.
And ran off. And it was satisfying for me because I've almost died a few times because right. of that particular character in whatever incarnation she has. But I'll be up front. Oh my God.
Yeah.
There was no lead up. There was no build through. That was one round of,
Yeah, and it wasn't something that, and what we're talking, I'm not going to go into too much detail because it's a printed adventure and I don't want to go, I don't want to spoil it for anybody. But essentially what it was just a group of barbarians that were trying to get into this certain area. And you came upon them and a fight ensued. And it wasn't that big of a deal except for one fact that they had a pet dragon, but it was a baby dragon. But a baby dragon's still tough, and the breath weapon still does a lot of damage. And that's initially what got her. It's like that breath weapon knocked out half her hit points. And then one of the barbarians jumped in and started waylaying on her, and that's why she ended up with almost no hit points. But, you know, up until that point, you guys were just – it was like a buzzsaw going through everything. And I'm wondering if it's level, character level, you know, at low level, they wanted to make low levels so viable because they don't want people, you know, losing characters and stuff like that.
And they want you to be invested in your character.
Right.
And then once you hit that fifth, sixth, seventh level increase, suddenly you've got to be more careful than you've ever been.
Right. And which completely, I mean, I get it if you're going to try and work it as a paradigm shift in a story or something mm-hmm. like that. But role players don't do that. It's, this game's easy. I can have my wizard lead the charge because I've been doing it for 5 levels. And then all of a sudden, bang, you know, it seems almost unfair. Because you're setting up your rewarding behavior, and then all of a sudden it's, no, you can't do that anymore.
Mm-hmm. After you've got already conditioned responses and tactics your group's been using, now people are going to get wasted for doing it.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like I said, it seems like bait and switch, right? It's this is the way the game is designed to be played, and here, have fun, learn to play it, and then all of a sudden it's like, man, this is a deadly game. Whereas before Pathfinder, or especially like second edition D&D, low levels, you didn't bite off more than you can chew.
You were very, very careful not to bite off more than you can
chew. Yeah.
And also with the experience systems, they say that, you know, level 1 through 5 is supposed to be kind of fast in D&D 5, and then 6 to 10 or 12 is supposed to be the bulk of your character's life. Or was it 6 to 15 supposed right. to be the bulk of your character's life? And then 15 to 20 is supposed to be pretty fast. What I like about Pathfinder is they have the 3 tracks of experience, kind of a fast, a medium, and a slow. And if you want, you can just say, okay, well, you know, you guys have hit 7th level. We're going to switch experience tracks from fast to medium, and we're going to draw this game out a little bit.
Right.
The monsters don't give you any less experience. It just takes you more to get where you're going.
Right.
And that way you can draw your game out and prolong the fun a little bit. Also, I prefer the magic item system in Pathfinder, but I'm a Geardo. You know, I like, you know, and D&D 3.5 is what brought me into that, and you stop.
No, I was going to say, the more I look at 5th, the more I play 5th, the more I realize, unfortunately, I'm a Geardo. Because I am walking into situations looking at combat styles, combat methodology, which weapon do I have to use, which armor. Okay, so if I take the breastplate and then I make it the mithril, it'll give me about what I want for that. But I need to find some, and I spend hours staring at the screen or staring at the books, looking for the advantage, looking for the because I have an idea in my head of what I want, and it's just going to be a matter of, oh, oh, that's going to take me 7 levels to get there. Time to either A, change the idea I have in my head, or go with it. And then I started micromanaging as far as, well, which rings, how many rings, which bracers. Is there a bracer that does this? Let me look up this stuff. And it got overly accentuated as far as doing it. But I liked having those options. Well, if I want to spend an hour going, you know, time to change the way I do a character because I need the money. I can't afford to keep trying to buy a, you know, Masterwork Mithril Warhammer and an adamantine axe and a magical, you know, cold iron spear. It's too damn expensive. So, you know,
I was expecting a comment on how much of a geardo I am. So, you know,
no, when I realized in one of the more recent games that I played that I was becoming a major geardo, especially in game wise. In my real life, not so much. I pick on you in your real life because in your real life you're a bit of a geardo. In your games, you're not so much.
Well, I like.
Yeah, I know.
And we'll go into
I like that. Options, and I think that's one of the things that turned me off to 5th edition is the gear set. They don't actually even have cold weather gear as something you can buy when you go to 10 towns in Icewind Dale. I kind of need a coat. How much is a coat? Because it might take us a lot of money to prep for this. I can't prep for this because there's nothing. Right. I don't know what I'm doing. Screw it. Yeah. Let's just walk in. I got flip flops and a loincloth. I'll be fine.
That's a very good point because I know that in a lot of the opinion about 5th edition and what some people say is a strength is the fact that they don't have a lot of the gear and stuff like that for people to get really ground down into. But when you just said that, it kind of like sparked a thought. A lack of gear, and this goes for any game. If you don't have a very detailed gear list, what you're doing is you're taking the power away from the player to control their own destiny, and you're giving it to the game master. Because if you say, well, you know, and this is actually one of the arguments is, well, in 10 towns, a seal coat would cost way more than in the desert because you don't need it in the desert. It'd be garbage there. Well, they're going to jack the price up. So if you have an arbitrary list of items and how much they cost, you know, then you're really just setting it in stone. And that means it costs the same here as it does down here. It's if you don't put a cost there, then the game master can haggle with you. Who the fuck wants to do that every time you want to buy a pair of shoes?
Yeah.
An accountant, maybe?
Maybe. I don't know.
I don't.
No, I know accountants, and they don't want to do that shit either when they're playing games.
Right. So, you know, my point is, and what I mean by you're taking the power away from the player is someone like you guys who, during your turn, you know how much money your character has. You can go through and say, I would like to buy this, and I would like to buy that, and you know how much it costs or whatever. You know, you could go to a town and I say, hey, look, you know what? You're in 10 towns and this is a whale fur coat and, you know, it's going to be marked up. You know, as a player, you'd probably accept that if it was a logical thing.
Yeah.
You know,
you give me a reasonable markup, I'm going to pay it and we're going to drive on.
Well, one of the other problems I have is that why do you stay in the group? In 3.5, when you're scraping together literally every single coin you can get your hands on to buy this gear piece that you need because, by God, you realize you have a problem with arrows shooting you and you don't like it, so you're trying to find ways around it and buy stuff. Whereas in 5th, I'm sitting with a rogue with like 2,000-3,000 in gold going,
I got nothing to spend it on.
Why am I still here? Why don't I just retire and do what I do in a town? Why the hell would I go fight giants as a halfling with a little bow that can barely break skin? Why would I bother?
With 2,000 gold as a rogue, why don't I just go buy a brothel and make people pay me and I'll sit here and that's what I'll do?
Right.
It's never been that much of a thing until recently we did Labyrinth of Madness, and by the end of Labyrinth of Madness, there was no, we didn't care about money. Oh, what's this, a 10,000 gold piece emerald? I don't care. Whatever, take it. I don't get it.
We don't have the encumbrance
spell. But at the same point in time, you there was so much else to worry about, to think about, to plan about, to figure out, to do. There was so much keeping in your mind. The money just wasn't the issue that it was before, because it was a non-issue, because we had bags and bags and bags of it and nowhere to spend it. And it was just sitting in a corner.
We got a barrel full of platinum dust worth 5,000 gold pieces. Right. And we just, you know, at one point we're like, can we just leave this somewhere? And we'll pick it up later.
It got to the point where the druids run around, they're like platinum dust throwing into things to see if it was invisible. And we're like, okay, we don't care. It's 5,000. Who cares?
Right.
But there was other stuff to worry about. That's one of the only times I've ever been about, okay, well, money doesn't work. Until we got to a town.
Right.
And I ran out of money buying spells because I had no damn spells as a necromancer without any necromantic spells, because we were stuck in a dungeon for 15 levels. You know, and it's, there were uses for other things. There were uses for ways to do it. You know, you had to get creative. You had to get careful. I mean, it got to the point where I was like, hey, I'm going to take this rock. This big heavy rock. I'm going to tie a rope to it and throw it down the hall and pull it back to me because we're not having any luck with traps. So maybe I can set off a few traps and we don't die. You know, there were so many other considerations, so many other things. Fifth edition, I'm just like, and I'll go prancing down the hallway. Worst that could happen is I have to make a couple of death saves. And you just don't let me die, guys. And you just prance down the hallway.
Right.
It seemed so simplistic that as an experienced gamer who knows the things that, who knows what a halfling thief is capable of, you sit here. What are you going to do? Something else. I'm going to climb up the wall and I'm going to run across the balcony. Why? Why not?
Nothing else to do.
Well, it's like a 100-foot fall. I'll be fine.
Yeah.
If I fall, okay. I'm going to ride a griffin. Why? Because I want to try to ride a griffin. I've got hooks I can put in its side, and I'm going to try to control him like a worm from Dune. Why not? Until the griffin falls on you.
So what I see with D&D 5 is it allows for more cinematic or more of the action that you kind of read in the books. Mm-hmm. That is kind of, we've kind of even dogged on for being a little over the top for some of the stuff in the books before. And that's, it allows you to do stuff from the books. It allows you to be more of a high fantasy, epic type character in a more simple way.
And yeah. Those are the only things that I remember about the beginning of it. I mean, yeah, I remember my frustrations, but I'll remember Zathros until the day I die.
Zathros was great.
That's because of this guy.
And it was hilarious. Yeah, and it's hilarious. And you can do it and you can play around with it. And I love the story aspects. I always love a good story. But it the game system itself just doesn't feel like it has the meat to keep me involved.
Yeah. One of our friends that plays with us on Monday, she said that now that she's ran, you know, 5th edition, she's like, I'll play 5th edition, but I don't want to run it. I hate running it because it's everything. What she did was she converted an old, I think it was 1st edition adventure to 5th edition. Wow. And ran it. And she was like, it was ridiculously easy.
Well, I mean, get back then. I mean, you had different damage levels for a dagger based on what you were fighting. Well, a dagger's not going to do so much to this and so much to this, so you have to worry about more and more and less scaling. Now it's just like,
Yeah,
I'll take down the dragon with a dagger. Hold on. Might take me a minute.
You know, but talking about, you know, you go into a dungeon, and back in first edition, it was, you know, a group of five kobolds or whatever that was a fight, you know? And it was like, well, I've got to throw waves of kobolds at them now because it's not the same thing.
At least it's not as bad as fourth edition where you just literally mow through them like wheat.
I have no experience with that.
I have little experience with it. It was kind
of
bad.
Yeah. So one of the things that I will also say with the gear, so with Pathfinder, the temperature rules are kind of a thing. There's one level when in the Emerald Spire where you walk down the stairs and all of a sudden there's magma flows. And every hour you've got to make a fortitude save or you take non-lethal damage. And so our group saw then like, all right, well, you know what? Let's go back to town. We got a bunch of stuff we're carrying anyway. And they got a rod of resist energy or a wand of resist energy. And then they cast
Endure Elements
on everybody to avoid that. And it kind of put that into ability, which was kind of a gear response. But, you know, if you come in that in D&D 5, it's like, all right, well, now you're in an area and there's magma flows and you're going to take, you know, heat damage or whatever.
Right.
It kind of changes that. So, you know, I don't know. I think with the right person running D&D 5, you'll have a good time. I think it's a great, for lack of a better term, gateway drug to bring people into the hobby. And hopefully as they go, they grow out of it and find something more in depth if that's what they're interested in, and move on to Pathfinder, Rollmaster. You know, things like that, you know.
Yeah. You know, talking about new players, I know of people who's, you know, their first game or first real long-term game was 5th edition D&D, and then to transition to something like Shadowrun.
Oh wow!
It was horrible.
I don't see how you can.
It was like, I'm not having any fun because I don't understand what the hell's going on.
You need an in between step to kind of ramp them up and make them realize that things get more complicated.
Well, the problem is though is, what do you find for in between steps when it's?
It's a good question.
I mean, how do you go from something like fifth edition to Cyberpunk, right, which is even worse than Shattered
World? Savage Worlds is kind of, I think, would be a good in between.
Yeah, maybe it might. Maybe. That might be a lateral move.
Yeah, that's true.
Because I mean, Savage Worlds. Don't get me wrong. I love that game. It's not. It doesn't have the level of intricacy as Pathfinder, as Rollmaster, as you know, Hackmaster. You know, there's a reason why the word master is in some of these games because you honestly have to master them. You know, yeah. It's true, you know. Games like Hero and I mean, as old school gamers, we look at it as if you could master these games, then you've got it. You're up there, you know. And that it's almost like a challenge. And that's kind of the old school nerd vibe is, I want to learn this game because that's the challenge. And then, you know, you go, then kind of what you were saying in the beginning, the dumbing down, it does sometimes kind of feel like it's a step backwards. And for people who have mastered a more complex game, talk to anybody who plays like the really complex Euro games, board games and things like that, and really love them. I'm talking, you know, like the really complex, like war games and stuff like that.
If you play Axis and Allies, if you play, you know, some of the even more complex board games.
Oh man, some of the war gamers, the that use the little chits for their units and stuff like that. And then you sit down and play, you know, one of the more modern or even the more just simplistic games, and they're like, oh God, this is horrible. You know, this is, you know, a monkey could play this game. And that's kind of the sentiment when it comes to stuff like this. It's, you know, we play Pathfinder, we play, you know, Hero, and to play something using different rules that are way easier, why am I doing this?
When you play Hero and each martial maneuver, there's five different kinds of punch and each one has a different bonus to your offensive and defensive values. And then you go to D&D 5e where it's, okay, I'm going to punch him or I'm going to stab him. Either way is a plus 11. I'm having a good time with D&D 5 because I'm with my friends.
Yeah.
And it's Eric running.
Yeah.
Which
I couldn't run it. I know I can't.
It could be completely different with somebody else running it. You know, if it were somebody else, I might not be there on Monday.
I think it is the friends angle that you're talking about, though. I mean, I'm having fun because I know the people there. Yeah, it's fun. It's joking around. When my character gets picked up and drug off and all the group yells is, my coin purse, you're taking my beer money. And it's just like, okay, that was good. I liked it. It made me laugh. I'm having a good time joking around them. And that to me is the reason to play it is just to hang out with friends. Period. I mean, it feels more like just hanging out than, you know, being serious about it. But maybe I'm still have a under a bit of shock from Labyrinth of Madness from finishing that one.
That's a good point. I mean, there is merit to any of that style of play. You know, if you want to be a beer and pretzels gang, you know, a beer and pretzels group, then be that. Yeah. If that's what the group wants, you know, if you want to tell serious stories and, you know, do serious character development and do all this other stuff, you know, then maybe this game isn't for you. Maybe Pathfinder is for you, or maybe Hero, or, you know, one of these other games that where you can, especially as a player. As a player, I'm sitting here looking at the way, you know, the game that we're playing, and I'm looking back at 3.5 D&D, Pathfinder, you know, some of these other games, hell, even Mutants and Masterminds, you know, where you can really mold a character to exactly what you want. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, in this, it seems very cookie cutter. You know, it's like I'm a fighter, or I'm a thief, you know, and that's old school. And I can appreciate that. And there's this whole push for the old school gaming, the OSR, the old school revolution or revival, however you want to call it. And, you know, and so you have a lot of these like independent games and up and coming games that use this old school feel, and I'm fine with that. But I think that D&D kind of went for that too, and in doing so, wanted to get back kind of to their roots. Because honest, I wasn't a fan of fourth edition D&D. I owned it and I ran it, but I didn't sell it until fifth edition came out, because I'm not, you know, I wasn't going to just throw it away, but. You know, looking back at it, and it was like they really that was such a hard change from 3.5, you know, that I think that maybe they overcorrected a little bit with fifth
edition. They went too far with fourth and then tried to bring it back, but didn't want to just basically rehash 3.5.
Well, I tell you what, if Pathfinder didn't exist, I wonder if they would have went back to 3.5 or something, some variation, but they felt they couldn't because Pathfinder already existed.
And one of the things I've seen starting coming out, we were discussing Monday night, is that now that 5th is out and they're starting to do things like alchemists and bomb users and gunmen, and it feels like they're trying to get that niche that Pathfinder grabbed by having all these things in this very, very nice, very detailed, very fun world, where you could do pretty much anything if you take the time to figure out how to do it. It feels like that's what they're getting back to. And I know it's 5th is new, so as more books come out, it's going to flesh itself out more. But it feels like they're, instead of easing into it with, well, here's a couple different variants, and here's close to what it's like, to jumping straight to something like, well, I'm a gunfighter with grenades. And then it's just like, what? Where did that come from in a game system?
Right.
Maybe it's just because it's new to me, and maybe it's just because I'm still, I don't know, it feels like it's now time. We've got our group, we've got our base market for 5 point, or for 5, so now let's try to take the entire market. Well, and I'm not sure if that's, I'm not sure if you can do it with something like 5. It just doesn't breed that kind of change. And I'm hoping that it doesn't happen, but I'm hoping you don't have a change from like 5 to 5.5 and it be so completely different that it makes 5 useless. Mm-hmm. Like when they jumped from 3.5 to 4 and they were still coming out with 3.5 books 2 days before the release.
The intermediate step for 5 to another game would be Mutants and Masterminds and other 220 games, because it starts to get you back more towards the 3.0. It incorporates further rule sets, but it's still a little more simple.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point.
Kind of came to me.
I was actually thinking going from 5 to 3 to something like. Yeah.
Well, because
it hadn't gotten as complicated as 3.5, and it was still very close as far as types of characters and capabilities before you really started getting into the crazy stuff you could do.
A lot of people don't. I mean, the gamers our age know this, but the newer gamers don't really. I don't know if they've experienced it the way that we experienced it, but I remember when D&D switched from second edition, or the player, what they did was they went second edition and then they did player's option, which was kind of like a precursor to third edition. because in that it gave you more options and stuff like that. But I remember when third edition came out and I was super excited. And it was, and I remember why, because I was looking at this and going, wow, there's so many options and so many different trees you could take to really do what I want to do, or just, you know, to explore. And, you know, the prerequisites and things like that for feats made it so that way I would, you know, okay, so there's a definite path to where I need to go. You know, getting fifth edition, getting rid of all these, all the prerequisites, you know, all of that. So that way, and I was just like, it didn't sit well with me when I heard that. I was like, well, the magic rules, I mean, I like them and I don't. They intentionally paired all that way back, you know, to the point where you can only attune to a certain number, and it makes use magic items for thieves mean something.
It can, know? If you can find the magic items, but at the same point in time, but the thing I don't like is you can't create your own.
Yeah.
There's no creation system. There is only, you can just buy these. From who? I'm sorry, you can't buy these. You can only find these or give these from favors. Well, how the heck? If nobody's making them, how they?
Because it. My character wants this. GM, my character wants this. Would you please design a quest so that our group can go off and we can find, hopefully, something for everybody, but so I can find this for my character.
Right.
You know, and then that's what it becomes.
Well, yeah. it was that whole system, because they kind of went to the rarity system, kind of almost like an MMO.
Yeah.
It's such a divergence from Pathfinder, because Pathfinder, you've got magic dealers on every corner, it seems like, you know,
and retired adventurers who started making stuff because, well, my back hurts, or I took an arrow to the knee, right. So I don't adventure no more. I mean, yeah.
We took this dragon's hoard, and I found a spell book from somebody who was a little more advanced than me. I ventured a little bit more, and I retired. I bought this bar. I bought this tower. And now when I need some extra money, I kick out this magic item, and I sell it.
Right. Yeah. So, you know,
It almost seemed like you had goals back then. Well, I know I have to be so powerful to be able to build this thing that I want, that I've wanted since I was a child. And you would adventure like that. You would get better. I've got a character now in Pathfinder that he's going to figure out how to make clockwork armor for himself, because clockwork's freaking awesome for a dwarf. And he thinks it would be where he wants to run around and basically what amounts to powered armor. And he's a combat engineer. A siege-breaking engineer. That is his entire job, and he has great ideas and plans for everything from airborne dwarven infantry, basically jumping off of a dragon with rings of feather fall so you stop 1 inch for the ground and then causing havoc, to mobile siege platforms walking around on clockwork legs, then putting down and firing and moving and then putting down and firing. And he's got wonderful great ideas, and he has a reason to go for it. He has a reason to do it. He has a reason to go learn more, to find, well, I've heard something about clockwork over here. I'm going to go over there and I'm going to try to find this stuff so I can figure it out. I'm going to go try to do this stuff. In fifth edition, it's just like, I don't have something to work for other than, what are we doing? We're okay. Well, let's go fight those things. Because it just feels like, as a character, I don't have a reason to go on.
Right.
They added the archetypes to the player classes. So you can play a fighter, or you can play a two-handed sword, a weapon fighter, or you can play a crossbow fighter, or you can play a bowman fighter, or you can play this.
And both 5th and Pathfinder have those, and I think those are useful, but I don't know.
I think Pathfinder changes the progression of the character and how things progress a little more than D&D 5 does, though. Mm-hmm. I'm not seeing, I mean, yeah, I'm playing an Evoker, so I get this, this, and this. Well, in Pathfinder, if I'm going to play this, that means I don't get this at level and I get this instead. And then I don't get this at this level, I get this instead. And, you know, I it's a little different. Again, Pathfinder's is a little more complicated, but it allows for a little more customization of your character.
Yeah. I went from being an alchemist. I played an alchemist before and didn't really understand the class, because I was only coming about once every month and a half, because, well, I lived 4 hours away, so I only came on four-day weekends. And so I didn't really get into the game until this time. And I looked at it and I went, I can be a sapper. And I'm running around as a dwarven sapper who traded in alchemist mutagen abilities. So I don't have any Incredible Hulk abilities. I don't have any Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde abilities. And that's perfectly fine because that would rip my armor. And, you know, and you got a dwarf running around in armor with a with a crossbow and a adamantine battle axe throwing bombs and setting explosive charges and det cord and everything else. And I'm enjoying myself and having fun playing it. And yeah, there are things I don't get. There are things I'm looking at going, but that would be great from, oh, I don't have that anymore because I'm specifically a siege engineer. Okay. And it works for me, but I don't feel the, maybe it's just the plethora of archetypes that you have in Pathfinder that you don't yet have in 5th. But 5th has like three archetypes for the different classes. And I find myself going, okay. I mean, I like playing rogues, but you can play a thief, you can play assassin, you can play like an arcane trickster or something like that. And it's just like, what if I want to move more towards something else later in life? No, you pick a level 3 and that's it.
Yeah, that's a good point. And my thinking is, given a long enough timeline, you've played everything. And then what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
You know? I don't know. I'm more of a character planner, and I know you guys are too. You know, I look at it as Pathfinder is good for the proactive character builder.
Yeah.
Whereas 5th edition D&D is more good for the reactive mm-hmm. character builder. I don't really know what my character is going to be, so I'll level a few times and see where things go.
Mm-hmm.
That's not me. I've been known to plot my entire 20 level career, you know, on separate character sheets. So then that way when I level, bang, I already know what I'm going to do.
Yep.
In 3.5, when we were playing our characters that went, I stopped at 33rd level. They went all the way to 35th, but I mean, there were times like, all right, everybody, it's time to level up. And Eric and I would go, okay, let's go. And everyone's there's like, wait a minute. We need, it's like, well, be prepared.
Well, I'm like that with, I'm not as much in D&D. I more come at it, I more react to situations. I know what I'm working towards, but I don't have to plan on every meticulous level because things happen. When we walk into a place, it's like, oh, well, there are lots of random portals to other planes. And you're like, so there's a lot of water here. Yeah, okay, I need a lot of water. So, well, there's a lot of fire here. Well, if I found water, I'm going to find fire. So now I've got to prepare. And it seems I do less and less planning in some of the D&D. But I like having the option to plan. I like being able to look for what's out there, look for what's fine, as opposed to games like Heroes, when I've got the hero designer and I've got 15 different variations on the type of character I want to play in case something happens or changes in their life. And what if I want to play it as more of a computer nerd? Well, here's another different entire rule set based on that particular power set. Well, if I have this suit and I want to play it more as an astronaut or more as a gunfighter, more as a straight soldier, and there are grandly minor changes, but it's planning out 350 points worth of 3-point runs.
Right.
I'm planning literally hundreds of runs in advance because I enjoy the story. And I like it in 3.5. I can do it. It's less obsessive, but I don't feel any of that obsession in 5. In 5, I was like, oh, I want to play a rogue. I want to play a rogue that is an obsessive hoarding planner because he's paranoid. And then went,
it doesn't really work.
It doesn't. Yeah. And I was like, no, I'm going to do it. Use magical items. I'm going to do a straight thief. He's going to, you know, what he's looking for is to have lots of magical items because he always wants to be prepared because by God, there's somebody hunting him and there will always be somebody hunting him. And then I got into it. And I was like, I can't even remotely make this kind of character. And then I started trying to force it into the kind of character I wanted to play. And I kind of come close, but I'm not invested in it.
It's an interesting thought that 5th edition shoehorns you into playing a certain way.
Well, because you can't change. All you can, if I'm playing a thief, because the thief, I want like the used magical items. I want the ability to pick up just about anything and use it, which is awesome. Until you hit about like 5th level and you're just like, it's really not worth it. But you're stuck. You're done. You either become a completely new class. I mean, I wouldn't mind playing like 5 levels of thief rogue and then you know, 8 levels of assassin rogue and start back over like level 1 assassin rogue. I mean, I wouldn't be getting crap for feats, but I wouldn't be stuck playing just this one thing. I want to be a two-handed fighter. Well, what happens when you want to put that up and pick up a sword and shield? And it's just like, right. You got nothing for that. You are completely useless when you pick up a shield in one hand and something in the other hand, and you never will be useful as that. Get it out of your head. You are a great sword wielder. You will only be a great sword wielder ever.
Right.
Otherwise, you're crap. You'll be awesome if you pick up a great
first
sword.
First or last.
Yep.
Yeah.
One thing that I do want to point out that I absolutely – I've already talked about how I really like the advantage-disadvantage rule, but I absolutely love the rage rules in 5th edition. I love the fact that a barbarian – and barbarians are near and dear to me, so the fact that a barbarian gets resistance, which means back half like, damage.
Back like second – when they just became unstoppable because they were just that tough, and whenever they raged, it just got worse.
Yeah,
that kind of thing.
Yeah, all damage that's bludgeoning, piercing, or slashing damage is all halved. You know, whatever the total is, halve it, and that's it.
Yeah,
it's super easy, and it makes barbarians very viable. You know, very tough, and that's what they're supposed to be. Mm-hmm. And I like that a lot.
Yeah, because you. It felt in 3.5, it almost felt like barbarians were just another type of fighter, and they just kind of were there. Whereas in second, it was, well, I have to wear lots of skin, so I don't really have a lot of armor. Why wouldn't you wear a big suit of armor? I live in the tundra where it's cold and metal will freeze my. So you know, they were tougher, they were nastier, they could take the damage, you know. And it had that. Don't get me wrong, it had those aspects of like, oh, that's magic. They toss it. Oh, that's magic and break it. And she's like, no, keep the barbarian away from the magic stuff.
Right. Right.
And but third just didn't have it. Third, I was just like, eh, there's barbarians, there's other types of fighters.
Right.
But this one, I love seeing what our friend Brandon can do with an orc.
Yeah, half orc barbarian. Yeah,
he's having a great time with it, and I'm riding in his backpack half the time. I mean, I'm enjoying it too, only to watch how much he enjoys playing.
Yeah,
well, that's more the player to player interaction than
true.
So
yeah, and half orc barbarian is right in his wheelhouse.
Yeah. So. And play what you're good at.
Yeah,
you know. I'll play an obsessive thinker.
Some people have those go-tos, you know.
All right, so final thoughts. What did you take away from this comparison?
So the game is part of who's playing it with you, and that can bring enjoyment just in and of itself. And, you know, I prefer a more complex, more robust rule system in a game. So, yeah, I'll play D&D 5 with these guys. I go to a con, I'm not going anywhere near D&D 5. I'm just not. So I'm not going to waste my ticket on it.
That's also because you can remember on what page and what paragraph you found that one particular rule that one time 3 years ago.
Well, yeah. All the combat maneuver stuff starts on page 199 in the large book. I don't remember the small book, but I think it's about the same. Anyway.
Well, you reference this. I mean, yeah. And you know, we both know that Greg's mind's like a steel trap when it comes to stuff like that. So, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I still.
I'll tell you what. It pays to have somebody like that around.
Yeah.
Just saying.
And I still do it without being a damn rules lawyer, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. You and our friend Aaron were. I loved having you guys around because I never had to look up shit.
Yeah.
Be like, there's a rule about. Oh, yeah. It's on what you call. Oh, okay. Drive on.
Yeah.
I knew it all the time. So well, does his wife.
And that's the other thing about when you've got a rule system that's a little more robust. If you've got guys at the table who are going to give you that little assist, and you know, when you say, well, I think it's this and we'll just go with it. If you go, well, I think it's actually this and it's on this page. Okay, cool. We'll go with it. Mm-hmm. You know?
So it could be complete bullshit. You just, you know, you say it with such conviction, I just believe it.
Yeah. Well, no, his wife will check.
Yeah, and that, but
it's
that's
got, yeah, it's gotten to the point where he'd be like, it's on page 100 on the left-hand side down by the middle. And that's it. That's all he'll say. As opposed to he's looking at me going, plus two, maybe plus three. It's a minus. And I'm just like, never mind. I don't really care. Don't bring me into this. And she'll sit there and figure it out. And she'll sit there and read it up. And then she'll go, oh, okay.
And that's the thing. I love when my wife runs games. And it also means that I get to play. And if I say, well, it's this, then she feels like I'm kind of taking over her game. But if I say, it's on this page, then she'll actually look it up, she'll reference it, and she'll remember it for later.
Right.
So that's kind of me helping her grow a little bit as a game master, and she does a very good job. And she also does stuff like she bought a Pathfinder third-party adventure called Snow White, and it's essentially, it's kind of like the Snow White princess thing. It goes kind of more back towards the fable, and it's more of a social adventure, but there's also some, you know, protecting the princess and kidnapping and some other stuff. And she wants to run it. I said, okay, I'll play it, sure. And then she goes, oh, maybe I'll run it for my ladies, because every once in a while she gets four or five girls together and plays Pathfinder or whatever, especially at Gen Con. Mm-hmm. They'll all get together for an afternoon and play for 4 or 5 hours. So anyway, so I prefer Pathfinder. I'll play D&D 5 with my group of friends, but I'm not going to sit down at a con table to play D&D 5. It's just my feelings on it.
Yeah. I didn't mention this in the episode, but I exposed my daughter's boyfriend to Pathfinder. He went with us to Gen Con this last year, and I don't, if you've not been to Gen Con recently, there's been a marked absence of D&D presence at Gen Con. And I never really thought about it because D&D's always been D&D. But then watching him we went into Gen Con and you've got the iconic Pathfinder characters all in these giant like banners and all the beautiful art, the Reynolds art just everywhere. And
the Paizo booth is gigantic.
Gigantic. And, it's like, you're like a kid in a candy store, right? And all this like overstimulation of all this awesome stuff. And we sat down before Gen Con and I ran 5th edition because I played a RPGA game with my daughter and her boyfriend. And so I ran a couple of adventures to just kind of get them, acclimated to the mm-hmm. rules and stuff like that. And
you don't want to drop a vanilla right into Gen Con.
Well, it happened and he's hooked. He started a RPG gaming club, official RPG gaming club at his high school. It's becoming a thing. So
we always had to meet in like the back of the drama class, the drama
in the band room at lunch to figure out when we're going to meet up on the weekend to play.
Right. So, but to my point is that, he got the Pathfinder mini rule book mm-hmm. at Gen Con, and then we got him the big rule book for his birthday. Yeah, and he absolutely loves it, and he loves Pathfinder, and he's a new gamer. He's not mm-hmm. He's not old school gamer. He's not somebody who's been, and he's played 5th edition and he's played Pathfinder. He prefers Pathfinder, and to me, I can play both. I'm fine with both if that's what the group wants to play, kind of like what you're saying, Greg. If we're gonna sit down and play, and let's say our friend Mike or somebody wants to run 5th edition D&D, I'm all for it. Let's play. If I'm going to have my choice, I'm probably, if I'm going to play it, I'm probably going to play Pathfinder because I prefer that rule set over 5th edition. I wanted to give 5th edition a fair chance to run it and really dig my teeth into it and everything like that. And having done so, my personal preference is Pathfinder.
I really didn't want to give it a fair chance, but I gave it a college try. And, I'm having fun because I'm with my friends. So, yeah. What do you think, Kyle?
I gave it a shot. I was very, very turned off by 4th edition. And then meeting, some of the people I've met over the years and getting into things like Pathfinder, getting into Champions as obsessively as I did. Because I used to be able to do exactly what you do on Heroes when it's 576 pages in the only book that you need kind of thing for rules, and I was good at it, and I've slacked off a little bit, and I've gotten less obsessive with it. And I've enjoyed games like Pathfinder, and I always want to get back to that feeling I had when I first played D&D, and that was back in 2A D&D in college. I had to go to college to realize I was a nerd. But that's just where I grew up.
Well, yeah, the problem was that, you know, our gaming stopped during football season because half my group were on the football team. So, yeah, it's like, yeah, we got away games we can't play. Yeah.
But it unfortunately, to me, I get that. I don't get it at all from 5th edition. I don't get that feel, that love, that excitement. I just kind of feel myself going along with the group because of the people I'm hanging out with, and I enjoy the people I'm hanging out with. Pathfinder, I enjoy the game. And I like the fact that 5th might bring in more people because I love hearing things like he started an official group at his high school. Right. And the story you shared a couple of months ago about the guy who's leading games at his local library. I think that is amazing. And if 5th edition can bring in and give an outlet to people who might not have that outlet, I'll play it any day of the week anybody wants to play it. I will not be as happy as I would be playing something like Pathfinder. But as long as it's new gamers, I don't care. Go for it.
Welcome to my hobby. Yeah. Let's be a good steward of the hobby.
Yep.
Come into our world a little bit, and you know, we'll get you hooked. This is your freebie, you know.
Right. 6 months in, I'm going to convert you to something else. but if this will get you to enjoy the game, hey, I think it'll be a fine gateway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As long as the player can transition to something, I don't want to say more complicated, so we'll say more in depth, more robust, but way more complicated. There are complicated games out there that can be rewarding. I mean, when you get into Pathfinder and you can be an awesome fighter, once you get your hands on a sword, you can obliterate armies, and dude walks up and kicks a sword out of your hand and beats you every piss out of you with his penis. I mean, it's you expect crap like that in Pathfinder, and you have to find well-rounded, well-balanced things. And I think
well, he's the dong fighter archetype, and he's a monk.
Well, yeah, sure. I'm sure. Yeah, let me throw this over my shoulder real quick because it's going to get in the way when I do the spin kick. But it's
banana dong fighter.
Yes.
Yep. Yes. Let me whip this out.
But I just really enjoy the feel of Pathfinder because yeah, I can do almost anything I want to do. I just have to have an idea. And most of my ideas in Pathfinder come from, well, let me see what's available. Oh, well, yeah, there's a gunfighter. Oh, well, yeah, there's a samurai. Oh, well, what is a magus? Oh, that inquisitor looks, that orc inquisitor chick, that kind of looks interesting. Now I want to play Solomon Kane. Now I want to play, okay, yeah. Other games I've played? No, the idea comes from, remember this thing I watched this time on this when I was a kid? I wonder if I could make that. I think 5th will be a great way to get people into something like Pathfinder, to get people into something even farther.
Right.
And as long as they keep improving and don't go a step back, I'll be a faithful Pathfinder. Yeah. And I'll be a mostly faithful D&D, but...
Well, Bestiary 6 is coming out. Let's see, what else is coming out? The Villains Codex is coming out. There's a couple other, you know, thicker books coming out.
There's like a 9-run, I was looking at the Clockwork stuff, and there's like a 9-run Clockwork series that's still in the process of coming out. People have literally been playing it for years.
Well, we might have to pick that up if that's something you want to do. We'll do that next.
No. I'm not looking to completely change it, but I like that there's a lot to do in Pathfinder, and that it is so open, and I don't feel pigeonholed.
Yeah.
If I'm making a fighter alchemist who's a sapper and a siege engineer, yeah, I can do it. But I don't feel like I have to do this one thing. I have more feats that allow me to do other stuff. If I've come across a skill that has suddenly tweaked my obsessive interests, I can do that skill. I can focus on that skill. I can learn that skill as opposed to the 5th when you can't really.
Yeah. There's another point. Actually, there's two other points that I wanted to make. Talking about people getting on their phones and stuff like that. I've noticed that with the more complex game, especially like Pathfinder, whenever it's not your turn, when it's not my turn in 5th edition, I'm paying attention usually, but I'm also watching everybody else when it's not their turn, and people will go to their phones, and it doesn't offend me. If you know, if somebody's going to go to their phone, they're going to go to their phone. It doesn't bother me anymore. But I've noticed in games like Pathfinder, people are going through the book.
Yeah,
because they're wanting to look up what their next move is going to do. They're going to see, you know, maybe their spell that they're going to cast, or you know, or maybe even just looking at the art.
Or they're going to the PFSRD.com so they on their phone so they can look at stuff there.
I was shut down the other day during a Pathfinder game because it told me I had tried to access the Pathfinder site too many times. I basically need to shut up and go buy a book. it said, no, you've been on too many times, because I was like, oh, what about something like this? Well, what about something like that? Well, let me
locked out the IP yeah. address at my house, not just his phone.
Interesting.
Oh, it locked out the entire IP address. Oh, sorry about that.
Well, you know, I got most of the books, so
yeah, yeah. And honestly, it was easier, and that's all I found myself doing was jumping on the trying to find. Well, what about this and Pathfinder? This and Pathfinder was great, but like in fifth, I was like, and Facebook.
Yep. You can't once you. Hey, with fifth edition, once you got it, you got it.
Yeah, you don't need anything.
And yeah, I was on my phone. I was paying attention. I knew when my turn was coming around.
I won't lie. There were two times they went, Kyle's up, and I went, shit, attack. Because yeah. I
you get distracted. Go to something else. Yeah. Yeah. But the other thing that I was going to say is, if you're going to contrast fifth edition D&D or D&D the product mm-hmm. to Pathfinder, you also understand that you're talking about two completely different business
yeah,
models
completely,
too.
Yeah.
You know, and one, you look at Pathfinder and you go, man, the barrier to entry is really high if you want to have everything. Well, you don't necessarily have to have yeah. everything. I'm a big believer in core books, you know, mm-hmm. and you play the core book and, you know, and I know Greg has thousands of dollars invested in all these other books, and I would never say you can't use any of your books, because I don't think that's right to do. But so the other thing that you got to look at is the fact that Wizards of the Coast, who own D&D, are owned by Hasbro. Okay. Mm-hmm. Paizo is an independent publisher. So really, even though Pathfinder has the more stuff, they're really, they have to, because the people who work for them, you know, they pay their mortgages and they pay their, you know, kids' schools and stuff based on the fact that they're selling books. Whereas Wizards doesn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of their stuff, they've already said they're not going to release a whole bunch of splat books for D&D 5th edition. Mm-hmm. But what they're doing is they're releasing stuff online. And so you can go to their website and you can get a lot of the like newer classes and newer stuff. Mm-hmm. They've revamped. I know they revamped the Ranger. They've added stuff for the Barbarian, the different totems for the Barbarians. All that stuff's available online, whereas Pathfinder wants to sell you a book. I mean, hey, whatever you want, however you want to do it, right? So you look at it as, hey, I can get this content without having to buy anything, which is all well and good, because Hasbro doesn't need that money, and they already know that they're not going to make a whole lot of money from splat books, because, you know, you go to any, if there's any brick and mortar game stores left in this world, you go in there and you ask them, how long has that Pathfinder core book been sitting there? It's probably been sitting there a while. You know, they don't move. There's a reason why game stores sell comic books and magic cards. It's because that stuff moves. Mm-hmm. You know, game stuff doesn't move. And that's one of the reasons why 5th edition went the way they did. So, yeah. I mean, that's the two different business models. You're supporting Pathfinder, you're supporting people and their families. You're doing it to a much smaller degree with 5th edition, because their staff is a lot smaller and they outsource a lot of their stuff. So,
yeah, and I agree with that. Yeah, I see what you're saying. I think Sean Reynolds has probably bought a summer home off what I've spent on Pathfinder.
You're welcome, Sean.
Yeah,
hope you like that car.
But you know, and I gotta say, I came into Pathfinder a year or 2 years before D&D 5 came out.
You came into Pathfinder angry at D&D.
I did. I came in
I'm
very
never
angry
buying game. Another D&D book. I'm just going to play Pathfinder, which is, I think, one of the reasons why you were so anti-5th at the first, because you were so angry with the company.
Yeah, I was. I was mad.
Yeah.
Still kind of mad.
Well, I mean, you know, especially with, you know, because you're talking 3-5, I mean, you can't go to Gen Con without seeing all the third edition, you know, third party books that, you know, yeah. buy one, get mm-hmm. 18 free, yep. you know.
I love those, yeah.
But, you know, yeah, for reference stuff, yeah, yeah. stuff's awesome. But, you know, essentially the thing that you loved was turned to garbage.
Yes.
And you're like, man.
You took a shit on my hobby. That's what happened.
Yeah.
You took a game that my first long-term role-playing game, the carrot was D&D 3.0. Mm-hmm. We'd played werewolf here and there, and we played a lot of White Wolf stuff here and there, but the characters that I got most invested in, the character I had most fun playing in, the game was D&D 3.0 and then 3.5. Then Shadowrun came along too, but my problem was you took something that was important to me that got me through some rough times and you shit on it. That was my problem. And, you know, so Wizards of the Coast got me back a little bit. I'm still not buying a bunch of their stuff because I've gone this way and I prefer that way. So that's how it is.
And it was that way more so with me with games like Warhammer 40K.
Yeah.
This is the way it is. This is the way it's good. You know what? We didn't sell these models anywhere. We're going to change the entire system to sell these type of models. And I went, no.
Yeah.
I spent thousands of dollars on this army that I enjoy playing, that I rarely get to play the entire army. In fact, I never played my entire army. And it's fun. It's enjoyable. It's completely worthless and useless without buying your new special snazzy models. Got it. I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm not done with D&D, despite the fact I was very upset with 4th edition. I still like 3rd edition. I had fun recently when we spent six months playing Labyrinth of
About 1 4-day weekend a month, one every other month maybe.
And it's like 10, 11 hours a day during those 4-day weekends when we would grind through. And that is the longest game
it's I have ever played. It's a badass adventure. Monty Cook did an amazing thing with it. You can find it for free online.
Well, for me, bought it and went, this is great. Oh, hey, look, it's a PDF we can download for free. Damn it.
Oh, you bought the hard copy?
No, I bought it on drive-through.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
And then I found it. I Googled it just to look at some other stuff to see if they maybe had a Pathfinder conversion. Because I thought about bringing the pain on a Monday night.
Okay.
And what do you know? That's out there. And then, oh, look, click this. And it just downloaded to my computer. And, oh, look, there's an interview with Monty. And he's talking about it. It's like, oh, great. Oh, well, whatever. You know what? I hope Monty still gets a kickback from that. I'm glad I threw him a little bit of money.
Yeah.
You
know? But for me, I mean, I'll always feel that way about D&D since that was the first game I'd ever played.
Right.
I had ideas. I had stories. I had things I was working on but didn't know I was a nerd until I met a guy named Rashad Allen. Everybody called him Al. And he went, what do you mean you don't game? Where do you work? I'll see you tomorrow. And he walked in and gave me a D&D core book and said, this is your new Bible. Read it from front to back and we'll talk. I'll give you 4 days. And I went, okay, and started flipping through it and read the whole thing and went, and he went, nope, 4 days. You got to have 2 more days to think about it. And I still felt it in 3. I feel it with Pathfinder. Not so much 5th, but I will not give up on like 3, 3.5. Like I said, that's the longest game I've ever played. I'm at 21st level going, I don't have a clue what I'm doing. Some people are like, yeah, no, it's just epic level. Epic levels are fun because you got to do it, and they'll go into spiels about it. And I'm going, I've never been past 10th level because we were always switching to new games because there were so many out there, so many fun ones to play. Pathfinder pretty much can hold my attention as long as it is a character. I have hard troubles coming into a game, like even 3-4 levels into the game, I just don't feel it as much as start from the beginning. If we all start on like 4th level, sure, that's fine. Coming into a game, it's hard to do. I don't see it being hard to come into a 5th edition game.
No.
You can literally walk in and go, well, I came in with a, y'all've got a lot of magic, but you don't have a bowman. Okay, I'm in. And it doesn't feel like I don't invest in it as fast. I can play it. I can have a good time. I can have fun with my friends. We can laugh and joke and make
horrible Long Golden Dong references for an entire night because of a bad model, because it's just a really funny model on the table, and it's fun, but I don't feel, okay, if my character dies, he dies. I don't really care.
Yeah.
As opposed to just about every Pathfinder and 3.5 game I played, no. I will run away and let the party burn just so long as my guy does not die.
Right.
I like this guy. This is a story I enjoy. You know what? Fine. Let them all burn.
You know, that's, I mean, that's a good point. And, you know, and thinking about it, maybe, I don't know, maybe I should try something different. I've come to the personal realization that I absolutely despise running book adventures. I despise running book adventures. And for this to be a lot of people's first experience with fifth edition, maybe it's an unfair shake. Maybe running a me adventure, you know, something that I came up with, where you can really invest in your characters, start at a grassroots level and, you know, do something like that. I mean, maybe it would be different, but I mean, the rules will still be the same.
I think though, that would actually make a big difference. 'Cause like Monday night, the party would have died rather than leaving. I think Brandon's character would have stayed in something that we weren't, that the book did not allow you to stay in. You have to leave, you have to run. Mm-hmm. Whereas I think if it had been not a book adventure, I think half the party would have stayed. And the other half the party, well, most of the party would have stayed to keep those guys alive and try to win the situation. And a couple of us would have probably left the entire party to die because that's the kind of characters we're playing. And we don't mind playing that kind of character. As long as we have a chance, we'll stay beside you. But when an ancient dragon shows up,
Spoil it. Let's just say that there was a very cinematic moment, and the first thing my character said is, I cast Fly on myself, and I grab the halfling and take off.
Right.
And that was the end of it. But we had characters that wanted to stay.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in a homebrew campaign, like not some, I mean, don't get me wrong, that was such a ridiculous thing that, yeah, the party's going to run.
Right.
But not making it quite that over the top in a homebrew campaign could help bring a party together, could help give you some of that love of your character or that love of the story or something like that. So maybe it is just the book venture for a home. I'm not a fan of book adventures, but at the same time, I'm not a fan of spending 20 hours creating all this wonderful stuff to have the entire party bypass it and feel like I need to slice my own throat open. But that was
yeah, you missed all this cool stuff.
There was a background and there was somebody will figure it out later.
Yep.
So I mean, I guess there's pros and cons for each of those. I think it would be, I don't know, I think maybe we could get into it more with a non book adventure.
Yeah.
Although you do make the book adventures fun.
Well, that's just because I'm like I can't keep running this vanilla adventure. I got to change it up a little bit. So.
All right. So.
Okay, so how you can find us?
Yeah.
Twitter at Trench Monkeys. On Facebook, you can find us at Trench Monkeys RPG. Our website is trenchmonkeys.com. If you want to get a hold of us for mail call, our email address is mailcall@trenchmonkeys.com. I want to thank Guy.
Guy.
Not sure which guy it is. We've had, I think, three emails from Guy, and I'm not sure they're all the same guy.
I think it's
the
same guy.
Same guy?
Well, okay. Thanks, Guy.
Might be the same guy. Thanks, Guy. So, thanks, everybody, for listening. Trench Monkeys, dismissed.
Oh.
Now, damn, talkative bastards.